Are we good to go? Good morning to all you in the sanctuary and to those who are on the live stream. Whoever you are and however you come, you are welcome here to worship with us at Orchardhill Church. We continue in our practice of lighting a candle at the start of our time of worship as a symbol that in the midst of life, in the hard times, in the good times, and even in the times of darkness, that God is with us, that his light will never be overcome. We consider this as we hear the choir sing, "Love Divine, All Loves Excelling." We stand together now and speak ancient words of faith. Today it's from Psalm 100, which is more commonly known as us to Jubilate, everybody. So feel free to use your instruments to help us keep time. Let's stand together and we'll say all the words as a family.
Jubilati, 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 Deo. Ti, everybody, serve the Lord in all your ways, and come before his presence singing. Enter now his courts with praise. For the Lord our God is gracious, and his mercy everlasting. Jubilati, 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 Deo.
Have a seat. That might have been me, I'm sorry. We're now going to pray together, and this is the family prayer that we've used at the last few family services, and we'll use it again today. So Lorna will come and she'll guide us through the movements. This is the time in our service when we stop what we're doing and we talk to God. So we sit down and we get comfortable and we ask that God will be with us in our time today. And as we know, God cares for us as a whole people. And the Bible asks us to bring our physical selves to him. And we suffer just now because we can't do the same physical things that we normally would do. We're not shaking hands or hugging. So now when we pray, it's good to use our physical bodies, using our hands and our feet. But of course, when it comes to mobility, we are all different. So I encourage you just to engage with this to the extent that you're able. Feel free to remain seated, to stand, whatever's most comfortable. Feel free to change the movement to something that suits you. You can keep your eyes open or you can shut them. Let us pray. We start by making our hands into fists and holding them out in front of us. Think just now about everything that's distracting you, concerns that you have, worries, things on your to-do list, deeper worries about the future. Whatever you come with today, imagine you hold them tightly in your hands. Feel the tension of holding on to all these things, the efforts needed to keep your hands and fists. In 1 Peter, we read, "Cast all your cares on him because he loves you." Let's softly open our hands and let go of our anxiety. Allow God to carry our burdens because he cares for us. Spread your hands out wide. In the Psalms it says, I spread out my hands to you. I thirst for you like a parched land. Our hands are empty. We are so needy. Like the parched land cries out, we cry out, O Lord, we're thirsty. Come and rain down on us. Fill us with all that we need. And as we imagine the rain washing over us and quenching our thirst, we ask God in our hearts for his forgiveness for all the words and actions that we have said and done in this past week that have hurt other people, ourselves and God. We ask God to wash all these things away and to make us new. Now, put your arms down, and if possible, move so your feet are touching the ground, and you can stand up for this one if you want. Imagine that your feet are the root, receiving the life-giving love of Christ. As I read this famous verse, use your arms to show how immense Christ's love is for us. I pray that we, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide, how long, how high, and how deep is the love of Christ. Now, church, you in whom the Lord dwells, let's raise our arms and praise God. Praise the Lord, all you servants. Praise him in the sanctuary. And we now say the words together that our Father taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our first hymn today is apparently an Orchardhill original. First we have Be Bold, Be Strong, and we move on then to Have You Heard of Old Elijah, penned, I believe, by our own Lindsay Barr. Now, we can't join in with the choir, but you all have instruments, and we can make a joyful noise. And I don't know if there's reactions to this one.
A wee bit here in the second one.
Right. Yeah. Keep an eye on Judy at the back. Let's stand.
Maybe
and.
Have you heard of old Noah and his floating tomb? Oh, like a little David, and he turned his sling. He killed like a lion, one little thing. The Lord on his side, on his side. We have the Lord on his side, on his side.
Ooh, yes.
Couldn't decide what my favourite book was, so I brought this. Does anyone know what this is? This is my Kindle, my favourite gadget of all time. I read every single day. Now, some people may say it's not as good as a proper book, but when going on holiday, I can't really fit 10 books in my suitcase, so this does me fine. I'm torn between racing to the end to see what happens in the story, and then I'm gutted when it's finished and I can't wait to find my next book to read. And I love being able to escape everyday life with a story. And one of my favourite quotes, which I heard last year, which was so, so good for last year, was, "Reading gives us some place to go when we have to stay where we are." So I've lost count of how many books I managed to read last year. My favourite are detective books, because I think I always had a notion to be a hotshot detective when I was younger, but I never work out who the baddie is in the book, so maybe I wouldn't have been that good after all. So, let's see your favourite books. Rebecca, what did you bring with you? Ten Little Superheroes, and what's it about? Saving the planet. Who's your favourite superhero in it? The pink one. Have they got a name? No, just pink superhero. That's cool. Now, Finlay, could you not pick your favourite book? You've brought a library with you. Oh, and what are they about? Surprise, surprise. Did you get a favourite one in that? Three, so you're working your way through them. And who's your favourite character? Is it Pikachu? That's the only one I know.
No.
Is it not? Who is it?
It is Ash.
Ash? Oh, never heard of that one. Oh, well. That's quite a lot of books, quite heavy to carry up the road. Now, I'm betting there's a book about a cat over here somewhere. Somebody will have a book about a cat. Who's that? Clara, and what's Clara's favourite book?
Warrior Cats.
What's it called?
Warrior Cats.
Warrior Cats. Did you not do a picture of Warrior Cats one week when we were drawing? It was very good, and that's your very favourite thing. And what about Sally? What's Sally brought?
Hetty
Feather. Oh, is that a bit, looks a bit circusy.
It's Jacqueline Wilson.
Oh, I like Jacqueline Wilson. She does great books. Who's your favourite character? Is it Hetty? And what's Martha brought with her?
The one and only Andy.
Now, that's a film you told me to watch, isn't it? It's supposed to be very good. That looks a very big book for you. Have you read it all? Or is it quite good when you see a film of the book as well to help you?
We've read it together.
Imagine it. Oh, cool. Well done. Well, Rebecca brought along a book about superheroes. So we've got all the famous superheroes, Spider-Man, Superman, Captain America, and their stories are all amazing, aren't they? And I love how normal people can gain superpowers and use them to defeat the baddies. But there's another superhero, not quite in such an exciting name. His name was David. He was very famous for taking on someone who was much bigger and stronger than him. And you know what? He won. The classic underdog story. Where do you think you can read about David? Finlay?
The Bible,
the classic book of lots of lots and lots of stories. Now, David started off, he was a shepherd boy. He was very musical and he wrote poems and songs that we still read today. And then he grew into a brave teenager who protected his sheep from the lions. Now, David one day became king and he worked very hard to keep all his people safe. He was a very popular and successful king because he behaved as God wanted him to. He had total and utter faith in God. And in fact, that was shown in a very famous story that happened before David was king. Does anyone know one of the famous Bible stories about David? It's David and somebody. Who could it be? Who knows? Somebody knows. Goliath. David and Goliath. Have you heard of Goliath? Have you heard of him? Well, he was one of the Philistines. And he wanted the Israelites to fight him. But nobody wanted to because they were all scared. If you're big and strong, nobody wants to take him on. But along came David. He was only wee. He wasn't in the army like his brothers. But one day he brought them food. And when he was there, he heard Goliath say, "I will fight him." Now, King Saul wasn't happy with this idea. Why not? Why do you think King Saul wouldn't want this wee boy fighting this big giant? Why do you think, Rebecca? Violence isn't the way. That's true. That is very true. And I wonder maybe thought he was going to be embarrassed because this wee person was never going to win. Or maybe he was scared that David was going to get injured or worse. But anyway, David wasn't scared. He said that he had fought off worse animals protecting his sheep. But he knew somebody was going to be with him when he was doing the fighting. Who do you think that was? Who do you think was going to be with him when he was fighting this big giant? Who do you think? Yeah? God? Yeah, that's right. So do you know what David did? He went and got 5 smooth stones. What good's that going to do? Goliath laughed. He had a sword. David said, "You fight with a sword, and I'll fight with God on my side." So do you think a small stone could beat a sword? No, surely not, could it? But maybe a small stone and God combined could beat a sword, do you think? Yeah, Finlay, you're sure? I think you're right. So do you know what he did? Does anybody know what a slingshot or a catapult is? Probably not allowed to play with them these days. He got that. And he flung it, and it hit Goliath right between the eyes. Collapsed. That was him toppled over. David had won. The underdog had well and truly won. Now, what about your story? Everyone here's got their own story, haven't they? What about the things in the book of your life that have happened? Maybe a time when you were sad or happy or excited, or maybe a time when you met someone who turned out to be really important. You've got many, many, many years ahead of you to all these things happen in your story. Now, you might not end up being a king or queen, and I hope none of you here become famous for, you know, killing people by throwing stones. But I strongly believe that everything happens for a reason. Everything may not go exactly the way you want it to go or exactly the way you think your story should go, but maybe that's because God's guiding you to another story, the right one for you. And throughout the years, everyone here will be part of lots of other people's stories. It's exciting, that, isn't it? Here we go.
Thank you, Lorna. It turns out it was me making that noise, so I'm sorry. Can everybody hear me okay? Yeah, excellent. So Lorna had told us all about the story of David. I'm going to invite Ian Anderson to come and read our Bible story for us today. Thank you, Ian.
This morning's reading is taken from 2 Samuel chapter 5, verses 1 to 5, and then verses 9 and 10. All the tribes of Israel came to David at Hebron and said, "We are your own flesh and blood. In the past, while Saul was king over us, you were the one who led Israel on their military campaigns And the Lord said to you, you will shepherd my people Israel, and you will become their ruler. When all the elders of Israel had come to King David at Hebron, the king made a covenant with them at Hebron before the Lord, and they anointed David king over Israel. David was 30 years old when he became king, and he reigned 40 years. In Hebron he reigned over Judah 7 years and 6 months, and in Jerusalem he reigned over all Israel and Judah 33 years. David then took up residence in the fortress and called it the City of David. He built up the area around it from the terraces inward, and he became more and more powerful because the Lord God Almighty was with him. Amen.
Thank you, Ian. So Lorna helped us think a wee bit about the different things that happened in the life of David. And Ian read this passage there, which kind of told us what happened next. Saul and Jonathan were dead, and David was made king again. He's been made king a couple of times already, but this time not in secret, and it was by the people. They came to him and they asked him to be their king. And to start with, it was just the tribe of Judah, because there's 12 tribes in Israel, and it was just Judah that wanted him to be the king to start with. But then eventually the other tribes worked out that they couldn't really do it alone. They were really struggling. So they came to David and they asked him to be their king too. And they came to him in need, in real desperation. And he was just a young man when he became king. And he stayed king for 40 years. And lots of interesting and sad and exciting things happened to David over his life. And we followed his story from the early days of him being a shepherd to the sheep in the fields. And now here we see that he's going to be the shepherd, the ruler of the whole people of Israel. And Lorna said, what's our story? And for many of us, our story is just beginning. For others, our story's had lots of twists and turns and is still going on. What's my story? I'll tell you that another day. Everyone has a story to tell. And sometimes so we can think, oh, it's not very exciting. I mean, who here's killed a giant? Anybody? No? Anyone called down flames? Floating zoo. Somebody's got a floating zoo, surely. No? I tell you what, though. We all have a story to tell about our lives. Something that God has done or where God has been at work. And in the olden days, I mean like 20 years ago, girls and boys, we called this our testimony. We called this our testimony. We told others where God had changed us or inspired us, and where we've noticed God has been at work. And I'm really, really sorry that John and Mary Miller can't be with us today, because I think they would have lots of stories to tell, lots of good stories to tell about things that God has done in their lives. Maybe we can hear about that another day. But we don't have to be a minister or a prophet or a king or a queen to tell others about the things in our lives that God has done. I first heard about God when I went to Sunday school. Now, that was about 40 years ago, so quite a long time ago. But I was wondering about the people here in Orchardhill, and I thought it would be really good to hear some of their stories. Now, girls and boys, I have put a question on each of your seats, and they've all got numbers on them. Can you see that? So when it comes to, when I say number one, if whoever's got number one can stand up and read it really loudly so we can hear it, I'm going to invite some volunteers to come. And now, don't panic too much, everybody. I've already spoken to the volunteers, so you can all just, you know, you can rest easy. So first of all, I'm going to invite Dave to come and speak to us. Dave Thompson, just hold on a minute, Dave. Dave Thompson over there, in case anyone doesn't know, is our tech guy. He organises the website and all the bookings for the services. He hosts the Zooms and the Desert Island Discs, and he does so much more. We'd have been quite lost in lockdown without Dave. So as Dave comes up, let's give him a round of applause. Are you ready for the children's interrogation?
Yes.
Good. Who has question one? Rebecca.
When did you first notice God in your life?
When did I first notice God in my life? Well, I think I'd have to go back to when when I was about 11 or 12, and I was at a Crusader camp in the north of Scotland in Portnochy. That's up in the Moray Firth. And I think that was the first time during that camp that I noticed that a presence of Christ in my life, definitely then.
How did you get to go to this Crusader camp?
Well, I had a friend who, and he invited me along to Crusaders, and we used to go every week, every Sunday afternoon. I didn't really go to church in those days, but we went faithfully every week to Crusaders down at Tinto, at the Tinto School, and yes, it was good fun.
Good. Question two. Oh, it's Finlay, good stuff.
Why is God important to you?
Did everybody get that? Good.
Why is God important to me? Well, I think that in life there's good times and there's bad times. And I like to think that during the good times he's always been there beside me. But more so in the bad times, he's been that pillar or post that I've clung on to get me through the bad times. I'd like to think that he answers every prayer that I send to him, but clearly he doesn't. But during the times when it mattered, I feel that he was there with me.
Thank you. Question three. When did you start coming to Orchardhill?
Oh, back in the day. Back when it was last painted. No. I there's a wee story to this, actually. I was selling trucks for Wiley's in the 1980s, and there was a chap used to come in to sell finance to the clients. And this chap's name was John Hay. A lot of you might remember him actually as being a member here back in those days, in the 80s. And he used to say to me every time he'd come in, he'd say, why don't you come along to Orchardhill on Sunday? You know, no, don't know. And he says, well, come along then Sunday morning. We've got this new young minister, he's really good. So one Sunday I decided, right, I'm going to take up his offer. And off we went to Orchardhill. And I felt a connection immediately. I came here. And after the service, I was introduced to John Spears. And he, in turn, introduced me to a couple of people that I've known ever since that first day. And it's Bill Blackie. And Alan Rennie. Alan's not here, but Bill's up there at the back. I can hear him this morning. And these guys from the early days have been friends all those years.
Question four.
Why do you still come?
Good question, Finlay. Why do you still come, Dave?
Well, I believe that over the years my faith has steadily increased and stronger. And Margaret and I, we brought our kids here, they grew up here, and we just can't imagine worshipping anywhere else.
Thank you, Dave. Let's give Dave a round of applause.
Who is the next victim? Well, our next volunteer is Irene. Now, Irene's another well-kent face in the Orchardhill family, a stalwart of the cafe, Sunday school, and so much more. She was one of the first folk that I really got to know over Zoom when I first came along, always keen to chat and tell me about herself, which is great. And she's volunteered to come and tell us some of her story of faith. Round of applause for Irene, please.
Question five, Finlay.
When did you first notice God in your life?
What a nice loud voice, Finlay.
Well, I think I've always known God in my life because we always, as a family, always went to church. And I knew about God, but I didn't really know God until, and it's a bit like Dave, when I was in secondary school, we heard about SU camps. And my friend and I thought they sounded good fun, so we thought we would go to an SU camp. And it was really good fun. We really enjoyed it. And people talked about the Bible and about God in a way that we understood. We enjoyed it so much, we decided we'd go back the next year. So we did. And by that time, I was about 15, maybe, 14, 15. And I thought, I really think I know what the Bible's talking about now. I really think I know what God, who God is, and I know what Jesus has done for me. And that was the beginning, really, of my faith journey. And I continued on through the years at SU camps and at Crusaders, like Dave, learning more about God and the Bible, becoming a leader, and so on. So that was my start.
Question six. Why is God important to you?
Well, God's important to me because I just feel he knows about me, he cares about me, and he's very much part of my life. And in everything I do, I feel I want to do things that are honouring God and will help other people to know God. I don't always succeed, and sometimes I make mistakes, and I go badly wrong, and I have to ask God to forgive me. But all the time, I know he's there, and he loves me, and he always forgives.
Thank you. Question seven. Finlay again.
When did you start coming to Orchardhill?
Well, I started coming to, when was that? When was the centenary? 2000. Well, I went to church in town at that point, and I was getting to the stage where I'm thinking, when I'm an old lady, which I am now, I don't want to be travelling into town to go to church every Sunday. And my good friend Angela there said, why don't you come to our centenary, do whatever it was, that wonderful pageant that you put on. So I went to that, and that was really my introduction to Orchardhill. And I thought, this is a really good place to go, and there's lots of lovely people here, and I was made most welcome. I enjoyed the preaching, and the next thing was I became a member here.
Thank you. And our final question, don't tell me. Question eight. Clara. Why do you still come?
Well, I think I'm kind of part of the furniture, really. I just get involved in things, you know, I get involved in the cafe, I get involved in the Bible study groups, I made lots of good friends, and it's more than just a church, it's part of your family, really, I think, being here, if you're involved in things, it feels very much just a part of a family, and that's what I enjoy about it.
Thank you. Let's give Irene a round of applause. Now, our next song, again, is an old favourite, and we all know this one, we've done it recently, it's We Want to See Jesus Lifted High. So there are actions where you can feel free to clap along or use your instruments. Let's stand together and praise God.
We want to see. to see Jesus lifting high upon a lift lies across this land. That all men might see the truth and know He is the way to heaven. We want to see, we want to see, we want to see Jesus lifting high. We want to see, we want to see, we want to see Jesus lifting high.
Beginning to get the hang of these instruments. That was great. Now is the time in the service when we consider how we can respond to all that God has done for us. And here are our announcements. We continue to run the food bank, collection point for Carnwardick Church, Wednesdays 10 till 12. Your gifts are really needed and really very welcome, so please continue bringing them. We can keep meeting on a Wednesday too, being part of the community of the family here at Orchardhill, and we're meeting at Buchan Glen in the outside area at 11 o'clock. So I don't know what the weather's to be like, who does? But please come along and join us, and I'll be there early, lying across many tables to try and keep us a seat. Wednesdays we continue again on our regular quiet time service, 7 o'clock on Zoom. Lovely service. Really encourage you all to go to the website and log in. Tea and coffee today after the service. Remember the rules. 3 households to a table, no more than 6 people. Keep your distance from everybody. COVID is still here, unfortunately. So, you know, but come through and have a cup of tea and we'll serve the tea at your table. As they said last week, we're planning on running the summer mission in August, so we'll be having a breakfast club as part of that. So we're looking for donations of cereals, cereal bars, snacks, that kind of thing, to feed the troops that hopefully will come. And any items that we don't use, we'll send over to Carnwardick as well. We're also needing cardboard boxes to help build some of the props that we'll need. So again, if you can speak to me, Fiona or Lorna, and that would be really helpful. And as Donald shared last week, one of our members, Alison McKellar, sadly passed away recently, and her funeral is tomorrow at the Lynn Crematorium. Details of how to watch the service online are found on the Orchardhill website, and please continue to keep her family in our prayers. We offer now our resources to God, and we reflect on all that we bring as we hear the doxology played and George brings up the offering. Let's stand together. Thank you. Have a seat. Anne Anderson will lead us in our prayers today. And if you're little, if you're under 12, say, and you might need some help to sit quietly, there's some paper and some pencils over at the table if you want to, and you can draw your own prayers to add to Anne's as well.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, we come before you today, each with our own stories. You know us all, and all that we have experienced, both good and bad. And you are always there to listen to us, with all our worries and imperfections. Help us to remember to come to you in prayer, to seek your strength and loving kindness, to give us the strength to carry on when life is difficult, and to follow your example in good times and in bad. Lord, help us to listen to you and to those around us. You taught your disciples about the kingdom through stories. help us to share our stories with one another. These last 18 months have been very difficult for many people. Help us to listen to the stories of those who have struggled and prompt us how we should respond to support our neighbours, both near at hand and far away. Help us to give voice to those who struggle to be heard, the weak and the powerless, the refugees and the dispossessed, those whose lives were hard and for whom the pandemic has made things so much tougher. As we begin to hope for a world with more freedom, help us to remember that there are millions in your world who still lack basic freedoms. Freedoms of speech, freedom from hunger, freedom from poverty, freedom from ill health. Lord, today we've heard again the story of David, called by you from humble beginnings as a shepherd boy to be a great king over Israel. Help us to learn from his story for our lives all these centuries later. Help us to remember that through you, we too can achieve things we could not imagine. There are so many ways we might make a difference, not as kings or warriors, but as your children. Help us to see where we can make a contribution to caring for your world, to building a more just society, to creating a more caring community. The pandemic has shown us that we can change and do things differently in many areas of life. Lord, show us what we can learn from our experience to make the future more as you would wish this world to be. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Way back, and again, the distant mists of time, 2016, when I was filling out the forms required to apply to the ministry, one of the questions that they asked you is, what is your favourite book? Now, this is my favourite book. It was then. Do you know this one, boys and girls? Yeah, you seen that one? Certainly my three. They quite like it. It's a book by Julia Donaldson. She wrote The Gruffalo. It's a great book. And this probably tells you much about the reading that I was doing in 2016. Anyway, it's a lovely story about a wee girl who has a nice mum who makes her paper dolls. Does anybody have a nice mum who makes some paper dolls here? You make paper dolls? Yep. And I occasionally make paper dolls too. So this little girl made paper dolls. And here they're here. My girls help me. They're stuck on a rolling pin. So we have, do you remember the names, Martha? We've got Tiki and Tacky, Jackie the Backy, Jim with two noses, and Joe with the bow. There we go. My favourite's Jackie the Backy. I like Jackie the Backy best. And in the story, these paper dolls go on adventures with the little girl. They go on lots of adventures, and she keeps them safe from crocodiles, and she keeps them away from the tigers. But along comes a wee boy, a bad wee boy. What does he do? Well, Finley looks interested at this point. What does he do? He rips the paper dolls up. You would never do that, would you, Finley? He rips the paper dolls up. And the wee girl is quite sad. And Tiki and Tacky and Jackie the Backy, Jim with two noses and Joe with the bow shouted, "We're not gone. No, no, no. We're holding hands and we won't let go. We are Tiki and Tacky and Jackie the Backy, Jim with two noses and Joe with the bow." And the pieces all join together with all together into the little girl's memories, where they found white mice and lovely heater slides and a king granny and a starfish soap and more lovely things every day and every year. And that little girl grew up to be a mother who in turn helped her little girl make her own paper dolls. Now this story is a lovely story. And I really, if you've got grandchildren, I think you should buy it for them because it's lovely. It speaks deeply to me about what church is. We're a community of people, and Irene said this as well, community of people who have in their bones, we've got DNA says church running through it. And many of us have come to this place of faith because someone told us about God. Someone invited us to become part of something that's meaningful and something that would become important to us. Now, this book can seem sad because, you know, the dolls go into the memory banks, but I don't see it that way. I see it as it's a reminder of what we do here. We pass things on to the next generation. We pass on our stories of faith. We pass on the way that we worship. We pass it on to these next ones that are coming through, and that's important. And part of what we do here is we make space for people. We make space for people to come along and to join and be part of our family. And sometimes that's for many, many years. And sometimes it's for a short time, maybe the length of a childhood. And then they leave us and they go on and they don't come back. And we wonder where they've gone, or we know that they've maybe went somewhere else. And we think, are we making a difference? But we are. It all matters. What we do here matters. We leave traces on other people's lives, like the girl in the book, like the memories and experiences that we share here. They will always be part of their stories, your stories, and they'll know that there's always a place for them within our fellowship. We're all part of each other's stories. And when church, I'm getting a bit violent with my rolling pin here, I'll put it down. When church is doing what it's meant to do, people can join our story and they can come part of the chain and we can hold tight to them no matter what happens. And we do this because we were first invited to be part of the family. We hold on to one another, and in the good times we celebrate, and in the sad or difficult times we rally around and we support one another. And we're part of the family of God. And we come together today and other days that we meet because we want to follow God and we believe that God is with us. Through David, as we'll see in the coming weeks, God establishes a family which will eventually lead to Jesus. And David reigned for a long time, 40 years, a long time, and much happened to him. And the Bible reading, it says he made a covenant with the elders. He made a deal that he would be their king and that they would be his subjects. And Jesus' ministry on earth was just for 3 years, but he changed the world forever. He too made a covenant with his followers. He made a covenant that we hear when we join together in the Lord's Supper. He says that the cup is a new covenant in his blood, that his body would be given for the world. Jesus is the new deal. And that covenant, that deal is still active, and we still have our parts to play. And our job, I think, now is to notice where God is at work and to join with him in whatever it is. Jesus' death on the cross was costly, and we often make it cheap. It costs us nothing because it means nothing. We don't share our faith because folk might think we're a bit odd, or it's private, or it's none of anybody's business about what we believe. But the Bible tells us that we need to pass on the gospel, that we can't keep quiet about it. Because if we do, even the stones will surely cry out. And as we heard from Dave and from Irene, part of their story is that they were told about God and they were invited to come and to hear more. Talking about our faith is important, and telling others is essential, because unless we tell them, how will they hear? And the world is a changing place, and sometimes the changes are fast and unexpected, and sometimes they're more predictable. But in the lifetimes of the people here, we've seen that the church has changed, and the ways that people will hear about God have changed too. But from the stories that we've shared and from our own knowledge and experience, we know that God is still with us. But we can't expect folk to wander in through the doors as they might once have done. But we do need to keep doing faithfully what the generations before us have done. And it's simple. Invite people to come. Speak to them about what God is doing in our lives. It's scary, but it needs to be done. We are part of this church, and we need to start talking about ways that we can pass on the message to the next generations. Some of these will be familiar, and they'll be things that we've done before, and some will be a bit more radical, but action is definitely needed. So we can't any longer just hope that, you know, somebody else will come along and do the hard bits for us, because that's just not the way it's going to happen. As you leave church today, there's some chains of paper dolls. Take them home with you, or make your own. Pick up one per household and write the names of those who you're concerned for, those who you long to come to see God, and use them as a prompt to pray for people regularly. Pray for God to open your eyes to the ways that you can share your faith with people. Simple actions, but life-changing for them and for us. We've heard today some of the little stories that make up the big story of our faith. Over the years, God has worked out his purposes through David, through Jesus on the cross, and our lives are part of that story. And that is amazing, and it's exciting. We're going to have our final act of praise today, which again is an oldie but a goodie. Clap your hands, stomp your feet. Let's stand together and worship God. We go now, and we go to proclaim the life-changing love of God to all who we meet. And may God be our protection and safe haven. May the power of Christ Jesus dwell in us, and may the Holy Spirit be our guide forever. We go in peace and love to serve the Lord. Amen.